Okay, thank you very much, Theresa, and the organization for inviting me here to speak in this beautiful library in this beautiful town. I'm really enjoying being here. I want to tell you about our project 101 Innovations in Scholarly Communication. This is a project I'm doing together with my colleague, Jeroen Bosman, who couldn't be here today, but it's really a joint effort. So first of all, I'd like to introduce you to some real people. These are real researchers. And I apologize for the lack of cultural diversity. These are people that we know, just some examples. These are our customers as libraries. These are our users. And they are increasingly using new tools in various phases of their research, various research activities. So for discovery, or analysis, or writing. New tools that enable them to do research in a different way than before. And as libraries, we should know what they're doing, and we should be prepared to support them in these new ways of working. And to facilitate that, that's what we've been doing is make an inventory of what's available, asking researchers how they're actually working, to provide us as libraries with information to adapt our services. So it's all about the real people. So to illustrate this changing research workflow, we put up a slide of a very simple model of the research workflow, starting with preparation, grant writing, coming up with a research project, then discovery, gathering all the needed information, the traditional literature search, but also searching for data from other people, that kind of thing. Analyzing, doing your own experiments, writing up a publication, publishing it, going to peer review, publishing it in journals, then doing outreach, getting the word out about your research, and finally, assessment. Have other people judge your research for quality and importance. And then the circle goes on. However, a simple model is always nice for illustration, but in reality, it's never that simple. And what we are seeing with all these new tools that are available is that this cycle is becoming more and more complex. It's not anymore the case that research goes through this cycle nicely in consecutive phases. We see more and more opportunities, possibilities of new tools that enable scholars to, for instance, publish their research proposal as a publication, put it out there. For instance, to get funding through crowdfunding. You have to already start your publisher, your proposal, and you start your outreach about your research even before you have the results to get the money. And there are other tools available that enable you to not only publish your final results, but to publish your protocols, your analysis, to publish your preliminary results and get feedback on that. Other examples, for instance, is traditionally peer review happens before publication. Peer review happens before you submit an article to a journal. Then the journal does the peer review and either decides to publish or not. But there are more and more sites and tools available that allow post-publication peer review, where the whole scientific community can comment on articles. And with this many eyes principle, there are a lot of fraud cases that have been uncovered and a lot of very useful discussions about the merits of scholarly results. So the main point of this slide is that the research is no longer a nice cyclical process. There are many tools available that allow a more fine-grained research process. And to sort of get to grips with all these new tools and new possibilities, what we did is we made an inventory of tools that are available. This is an ongoing project. What we put up here is a snapshot of 101 innovations. And these are not the most popular ones, necessarily. These are not the most important ones, necessarily. These are the ones that at the time they were introduced, they really signified something innovative. They signified something, a change in the way research was done or could be done. But this is what, that was our criteria for putting tools on this visual, on this infographic. We also have a database that has a lot more tools, like there are now over 500 of them, for different phases of the research cycle. So again, discovery, analysis, writing, etc., grouped by research activity. You have a link on that to that on your handout, and that might be a really good way to see what's out there, what's available for your researchers. This is really just a snapshot of it. So this is what's available, and that tells us something about how scholarly communication is changing, what inventors, small startups, big publishers are putting out there for researchers. But the big question, of course, is, are researchers using these tools? And that's why we now have a big survey out, a survey on scholarly communication tools, where we actually ask researchers, okay, what tools do you use at the moment? For instance, for discovery. What discovery tools do you use? What tools do you use for during your analysis phase to share your research protocols, if you do that? What tools do you use to assess impact of publications? Do you use the traditional impact factor, or do you use more newer tools like Altmetrics or Impact Story? Or you can see with every question, we have another possibility, and we really ask people to list all the tools they use. And I'm really glad people are actually doing that. So we're not stuck with these 7 answers per question. We really have a nice overview of everything that people use. This survey is it's online. It's very quick and easy to fill out. People really seem to like it. And so far, we've had over 5,000 responses already, which enables us to do some preliminary analysis. And what I put up today as an example is survey results for researcher profiles. What researcher profiles are people actually using? Which one do you think will come up on top? Google Scholar Citations? Actually, it's ResearchGate. ResearchGate turns out to be very popular among researchers, and Google Scholar Citations is a good second. This is a sample of almost 3,500 researchers across all disciplines, across all career stages, so it includes PhDs up to faculty, and across all countries. So it's really a broad picture. It will be very interesting later on to break this down to different disciplines, to see what the differences are between different disciplines or different countries or different research roles. And what we also did was compare this to what we as librarians, at least librarians who filled out the survey, say we recommend to researchers. And that's also really interesting information to see that that doesn't always correspond one-to-one to what researchers are using. As librarians, we overwhelmingly say that we promote ORCID. Well, much smaller percentage of research actually use it. And for ResearchGate, it's the opposite. It's very popular among researchers and a bit less popular among librarians. It's not to say that either of them is right or wrong, but it can make us think as libraries about this mismatch, maybe, between what we are recommending and what researchers are using, and what choices we should make in that. Should we double our outreach on some tools? Should we maybe adapt to what researchers are using? These are very interesting discussions to have as a library, I think. And all what we hope to provide with this survey is really the empirical data to underpin those discussions. And I'd like to stress that it's not about the individual tools. It's not about 101 tools. It's not about 400 tools. It's really what these tools are signifying about the way people are working. And one way to look at that is to look at different ways of working, different types of workflows. You can maybe characterize people as working more traditionally, using tools that are really not that much different from tools we had in the print area. Or another group of people might be more willing to experiment with new tools and to try out new tools and new ways of working. And you might need to support these people in different ways. And the second way to look at these workflows is by looking at them from the eyes of publishers, if I take the liberty to step in those shoes. What we see that publishers are increasingly trying to do is to provide a whole suite of tools encompassing the whole research workflow. So researchers can use tools from one specific publisher throughout their research workflows. And it will be very interesting for us to see if that's really what researchers are doing, or maybe there are researchers who are actively trying to pursue a more open science workflow, choosing tools, picking and choosing tools that enable them to openly share their research in every stage of the research. Now, open science is one aspect of that, but also open data, pre-registration of the plans for your research, open data, all that. So this is one way to use the knowledge about tools to characterize the way researchers are working. And this slide, I won't go into detail, don't be afraid, but we elaborated on that a bit more. And we looked at, okay, looking at these tools, what tools are on offer? What tools do we see people using? And that's really an ongoing issue with the survey. But looking at that landscape of tools, what can we identify as important developments in scholarly communication in the different phases of the research workflow? And I think that's really important for libraries to have that conversation and then to decide, okay, which of these developments do we think, or do you think at your library or in your country, are the most important? Where would you put your 2 cents on? Be that collaborative writing, or outreach, or changes in the way research is assessed, like altmetrics, post-publication peer review. What do we as a library think is important? And then, how do we change the way the services we offer to support researchers in that? Because it will be very ambitious to try to support everything. I think we should make choices. These choices may differ for different disciplines, different libraries, different countries. But if you know what's happening, you can make informed choices and then adapt your services. And that's something in Utrecht we're also still working on, struggling with. We haven't, it's really an ongoing process. We don't have the answers either. But we're really looking also at how can we provide services for different phases in the research workflow. And again, our data from our tool inventory and our data from our survey may provide information that can help support these decisions. So this is something I would like to invite you to think about in the near future, to have discussions about in your library, and thinking about, okay, where do we position ourselves in the future to best support our researchers? But there's also something you can do immediately next week. And that's help distribute our survey. Because we've got more than 5,000 responses so far, which is great. But to be really meaningful for the whole research community and the whole library community, it's really important that we get a global coverage of this survey. And as you can see from this image, this is data from 2 months ago. You can see we had nice coverage. A lot of responses from Anglo-Saxon countries, from Western European countries, but other parts of the world, response was still lacking. And that's why we have now translated our survey in more languages. It's now available in, apart from English, in French, Spanish, Russian, and simplified Chinese. And we're working very hard to also make Japanese and Arabic available in the next couple of weeks. So we hope that will help reach, potentially reach more people. But we can't do that alone. And that's why I would really like to invite you to think about a way to help us distribute this survey. And it's not just for us, it's for all of us, because the data will be very important for the whole library community. And you can also profit from that yourself in a very concrete way, because we offer the possibility to distribute this survey that you've all seen. You've all received a link to this survey. And this link was specific to this community. So in the breakout sessions, I will show some results from what you as a community said in that survey. And you can have the same data for your own institution, for libraries in your own country. If you distribute the survey with a special link within your own institution, you will get from us the data for that institution. And you can see what your own researchers are saying and doing, and adapt your services to that. So for instance, coming back to these real people, you can use that to reconsider tools that are practiced in information literacy classes. Which tools do you promote? You can support licensing decisions based on what people at your institution are actually using. We find it really useful when you go into talks with groups of people, PhDs from economics or researchers in medicine, and you can really go to them and say, okay, we see worldwide that people in your discipline are using these kind of tools. It's really a good starting point for a discussion. You can also compare research practices in your own institutions with trends nationally or worldwide. And you can find out what your users think about open access, open science, and what kind of tools they're actually using. So all these are really practical uses of these survey data for your own institution. And in the end, it all comes down to showing that as a library, you work with your researchers. You're actually listening to them, you're watching what they're doing, and you're trying to best position yourselves to support them, rather than just telling them, okay, we think that this is important and this is what you should do. So we hope that our work on tool inventory and mostly our survey to ask people what they're actually using will help you as libraries support this kind of work, and thereby supporting your researchers. So I'd like to thank you, and I also would like to invite anyone in the breakout session to have more discussions about these developments, and anyone who's interested in using the survey for your own institution, please come talk to me, because we're really happy to collaborate on that. Thank you.